This video is part 5 in a series about Super Nintendo Entertainment System features. You hear about it all the time. This one's all about Background Mode 7 and what it is capable of. Background Mode 7 is unique and different from any of the other 7 background modes, both in functionality and mechanically. In part 3, we showed how background graphics and tile maps were stored in video RAM. Well, when working with Mode 7, you can throw all that out the window, since it uses its own special format. The graphics and tile map are interleaved, and its location is hard-coded to VRAM address 0. This was done to simplify the pipeline required for all of the math involved in displaying the screen. Each character is 8 by 8 pixels in size, which requires 64 bytes, 1 byte per pixel. The pixels are named off in order from left to right, top to bottom. In direct color mode, these can be 8-bit RGB values, otherwise, they are entries into the 256 color palette. There are no bit planes or anything to worry about, everything is laid out just like you would expect. A total of 256 characters can be stored in VRAM at once, which equates to 16 kilobytes. This is 1/4 of the available space in VRAM. The tile map is pretty simple too. There are 256 characters, so 8 bits is enough to be able to reference any one of them. This means the tile map consists of 1 byte per character. The tile map for a Mode 7 background is 1024 by 1024 pixels large, or 128 by 128 characters. This also equates to 16 kilobytes. Like mentioned before, the graphics and tile map are meshed together, and they take up the first half of VRAM, from word address 0 to 3FFF. The reason for this interleaving is that the high and low bytes of each word in VRAM is actually stored on different memory chips. When interleaved like so, all of the graphics are found on one chip, and the entire tile map is found on the other. Another design decision to simplify the hardware process. It is worth pointing out that Mode 7 actually has the ability to enable a second background, referred to as the extended background. It's called extended because supposedly it was to allow an external source to feed in graphics data to mix into the pipeline. But that was never actually implemented, so it's not very useful. Now, it just enables Background 2, which is an exact copy of Background 1, except the most significant bit of the character data is treated as a priority bit instead of a color bit. This cuts the number of colors available to the background in half, reducing it to a 7BPP image, but now each pixel can have a high or low priority. This makes it possible for an object to be half in front and half behind a character. The main feature of Mode 7 is the ability to perform an affine transformation to the background. Affine transformations include translation, scaling, rotation, reflection, shearing, and any composition of these effects. Any perspective or non-linear effects cannot be done by Mode 7 transformations alone, and must be combined with HDMA to be performed, which will be covered in a future video. There are 8 parameters in total that define the transformation. The first two are the horizontal and vertical scroll registers, which are the same ones used by all background modes. These define the screen's position within the transformed space. When the transformation is static, these registers are easiest to modify to allow screen scrolling without needing to figure out a bunch of math. The other 6 parameters are unique to Mode 7. The X and Y center coordinates define the origin of the transformation. This can be thought of as the fixed point of the transformation, the center of rotation or scaling. The last 4 parameters, we'll call A, B, C, and D, control exactly how the screen is stretched or squished. A and C modify the horizontal skew, while B and D modify the vertical skew. Later, you will see that these 4 parameters can be fit into a matrix to define the transformation mathematically. Let's see how each of these parameters comes into play by providing a visual example of what is going on. In part 4, it was explained how a scrolling background can be seen as moving the screen around a tile map, or moving the tile map behind the screen. Well, in the world of Mode 7, it turns out that visualizing it as a screen moving around a tile map is much easier to understand. The only quirk is that now the screen won't always stay as a rectangle. To see what the actual screen would look like, the screen boundary here needs to be reformed into a rectangle. As a reminder, Mode 7 can only perform affine transformations without the use of HDMA. This creates a restriction on the shape of the transformed screen. It will always be a parallelogram. Another function unique to Mode 7 is the ability to specify what happens outside the bounds of the background. In all other background modes, the tile map just repeats over and over again, but Mode 7 has a couple extra options. In addition to the repeating background, it is also possible to repeat only a single 8x8 tile, or to not display any tile at all and let the background color show through. These options are useful when displaying a world map, for example. Here are the 8 parameters: the background scroll registers V and H, the center coordinates X0 and Y0, and the matrix parameters A, B, C, and D. The screen will be represented by this rectangle. By default, it is 256 by 224 pixels in size, which takes up less than 1/16th of the entire tile map. It sits at the top left corner, where the background scroll values are 0, 0. The origin will be represented by this set of axes. It will also sit at the top left corner, where the center coordinates are 0, 0. The length of each axis is determined by the matrix parameters. The x-axis is defined by the coordinates AC, and the y-axis by BD. The untransformed axes, or identity transformation, results in the axes being 100 hex, or 256 decimal, pixels in length in both the x and y directions. The output of this transformation makes the background display as if it were any other background mode, since it isn't changed in any way. By changing the background scroll registers, we can scroll the background just like any other. Let's increase the length of the x-axis by increasing the A parameter. When the transformation axis becomes longer, the screen stretches out and fits more of the tile map on screen. This makes the background seem to shrink. If we scroll the background first and then increase the axis, you can see how the screen is fixed against the transformation axes and scales along with it, keeping the center at the origin. We can move the origin inside of the screen region to see how this moves the center of the transformation. The x-axis doesn't have to stay horizontal either, it can be skewed up and down with the C parameter. Now things are getting stretchy. You can see how the A and C parameters change the horizontal skew of the background since all vertical lines are still preserved. The B and D parameters control the vertical skew, and similarly change the position of the y-axis of the transformation. Even with all of these parameters changing, the center stays put, since it is the fixed point of the transformation. Once a transformation has been made, the entire background can be scrolled around by changing the V and H values. This looks kind of funky in the tile map space, since the transformation is applied after the background scrolling, but it looks straightforward in the output space. A common transformation is simple rotation, so let's see what that looks like. The transformation axes need to rotate around the center, but they need to always stay the same length and stay 90 degrees apart from one another, or else the image will look distorted. We'll look at rotation again later, after going over the math behind all of this. Behind all of this is a fairly simple math formula that is calculated for every pixel on the screen. The inputs are the X and Y screen coordinates, we'll call XI and YI, as well as the 8 parameters, V, H, X0, Y0, A, B, C, and D. The outputs are the two X and Y coordinates, we'll call X' and Y', that specify the pixel on the tile map to display on the screen at the coordinate XI, YI. Throughout this segment, the hex values of these parameters will be converted from a signed hexadecimal number to a fractional decimal number. We'll switch bases and divide by 256, so a value of hex 100 corresponds to a decimal value of 1.0, and hex FD80 corresponds to negative 2.5. First, we should look at a simpler case, a subset of affine transformations called linear transformations. These include reflections, scaling, shearing, and rotation, but excludes translations, as the origin 0, 0 is always the fixed point. Without any modification, the identity transformation, the coordinates of the transformation axes are 1, 0, and 0, 1. Trivially, X prime equals XI, and Y prime equals YI. Now, if we were to modify the A parameter, the screen would be scaled in the X direction like this. This doesn't change any of the Y coordinates of the output, but the X coordinates are changed. Specifically, a change in the X input causes a different change in the X output. Thus, X prime equals A times XI. We can verify this by seeing that the input X values are scaled by a factor of A, and the Y values are unchanged. Secondly, we modify the C parameter. This results in the horizontal being skewed up or down. Now, both the X and Y coordinates of the output are changed. We can see that a greater change in the X input now causes a change in the Y input. Thus, Y prime equals C times XI plus YI. Vertical distances are preserved, but a change in the X direction now induces an additional change in the Y direction. These two steps can be done similarly for the Y axis. Modifying the D parameter scales the screen in the Y direction. Now Y is scaled by D, so Y prime equals C times XI plus D times YI. And finally, varying the B parameter skews the verticals left and right. This creates another term to be added to the X coordinate, so X prime equals A times XI plus B times YI. These two equations allow for any linear transformation on the input coordinates XI, YI on the screen, and the corresponding output coordinates X prime, Y prime on the tile map. That is to say, the pixel on the screen at XI, YI will be colored as the pixel on the tile map at X prime, Y prime. We can write these equations more succinctly as a matrix vector product like this. This will come of use later. Now let's step back to affine transformations. Linear transformations aren't able to deal with translations, so we'll have to do some extra work to apply what we just figured out in this case. We can do this by temporarily undoing any translations and setting the origin back to 0,0, then reapplying the translations afterwards. Suppose we had some Mode 7 transformation where we had the screen scrolled to the position HV, the center located at X0, Y0, and the matrix parameters A, B, C, and D. Our input variables that correspond to the screen are no longer trivial. Now XI equals X plus H, and YI equals Y plus V, since the screen has been scrolled. First, we will move the center of the transformation to the 0,0 location so we can apply a linear transformation. We can do this by subtracting X0 from all of the X coordinates and subtracting Y0 from all of the Y coordinates. Now, XI equals X plus H minus X0, and YI equals Y plus V minus Y0, and we can apply the formula we derived earlier. Plugging in these two expressions to the two formulas, and we get X prime equals A times X plus H minus X0 plus B times Y plus V minus Y0, and Y prime equals C times X plus H minus X0 plus D times Y plus V minus Y0. Finally, we have to reapply the translation we did by adding back X0 and Y0 to the X and Y coordinates, respectively. Our final result of the Mode 7 transformation is X prime equals A times X plus H minus X0, plus B times Y plus V minus Y0, plus X0, and Y prime equals C times X plus H minus X0, plus D times Y plus V minus Y0, plus Y0. We can also write this in matrix form, although it is not only a product anymore. To be complete, we would then need to convert these values back into hex, multiply by 256, and truncate to the nearest bit to find the coordinates into the tile map. We would also need to check the bounds on these output coordinates and take the appropriate measures if they are outside the bounds of the tile map. Before moving on to real examples, we'll revisit the rotation transformation. If you wanted to rotate the screen by some angle theta, you would have to calculate the matrix parameters A, B, C, and D that correspond to that rotation. There is a pretty simple way of defining this transformation in terms of theta instead of these four parameters. The SNES only takes these parameters, but having a subroutine that returns these parameters given a specific angle would be really useful. Suppose we rotate the screen about the center at an angle of theta counterclockwise. In a rotation, The angle between the transformed axes is preserved at 90 degrees, and the lengths of these axes are unchanged from the original length of 1. We can use the triangles formed by the transformation axes to find the values of the matrix parameters. Looking at the bottom triangle, we see that the cosine of theta equals the adjacent edge, d, over the hypotenuse, 1, which just results in d. The sine of theta equals b over 1, or just b. And from the top triangle, the cosine of theta equals a, and the sine of theta equals negative c, since we are rotating counterclockwise above the screen. Flip these equations around, and you get a equals cosine theta, b equals sine theta, c equals negative sine theta, and d equals cosine theta. These can be plugged into the general transformation formula to create a formula specifically for rotating the screen by an angle theta. Finally, we'll just show some examples of Mode 7 transformations that don't use HDMA and show the screen transformations in real time. First is the intro screen of Super Metroid. You can intuitively reason that the transformed screen is a background layer. A lot of other games make things that you might think were objects but are actually placed on backgrounds, like the pendulum in the splash screen of Chrono Trigger. Here it is again in slow motion. This is because objects cannot be rotated, only backgrounds can without extra hardware. Even Bowser at the ending of Super Mario World is on a background. You might notice that some of the rotations here seem to stutter a bit and aren't very smooth. This is because trigonometric functions like sine and cosine are not very computationally friendly. In this case, the matrix parameters for Bowser rocking back and forth and flipping upside down are hard-coded. If more precision is needed, like when Bowser is defeated and flying away, a lookup table for the sine and cosine functions are used instead of calculating them directly. Most Mode 7 transformations on actual scenery backgrounds make use of HDMA to produce a non-linear perspective or split-screen effect. We'll touch on Mode 7 again a little bit when we introduce HDMA later. Until then, thank you for watching.